Welcome back, everybody, to the Vortex Nation podcast, and welcome to TSS 10 to 100, where my compadre here, Ryan Muckenhern, and I tackle a scientific experiment, as scientific as we could make it at this point in time, test of some federal TSS loads that we shot from 10 yards to 100 yards.
It was raining that day.
It was raining every day we tried this. In fact, yeah. Snowing. We had the experiment, I'll say, scheduled. Then we got a giant snowstorm. So we're like, well, today's not like a great day to do it. Then we're going to do it again.
Yep.
Rain all day.
Whole week.
All week. Yeah. So we postponed it. I had to go out of town. Ryan, you stepped in as proxy. And we still got rain, apparently.
We did.
We can't beat the rain around here. It's been a wet spring so far, I guess.
I'll take it.
We need the moisture.
We do.
So that's the positive. Always a silver lining. But we'll set some baselines here of what we conducted the test with.
Yep.
So for a firearm, we've got a Benelli M2 affixed atop it. We've got a Picatinny rail with a Spark Solar red dot, which I would say, you know, we've talked about it many times, but if you're going to be, you know, attempting to extend your effective range on turkeys, a red dot is a phenomenal way to go. We've got the load that we kept consistent throughout this test was federal TSS 3-inch 7s. Ryan, you made this phenomenal chart, by the way.
It's the most math I've done since high school.
And I appreciate it because it's very telling of kind
very,
of...
I felt validated when I got done with it.
Other baseline things. So we've got the shot shells, we've got the gun, we've got the optic, going here at 1,200 feet per second.
Mm-hmm.
Number 7 shot.
Mm-hmm.
That's definitely important. We're running the 7s out of this. Mm-hmm. So we had the option of 9s or 7s. We selected the 7s. That's what I had, which actually kind of makes me... I was feeling these boxes, which were my boxes of TSS.
And thank you for that, Mark.
They're a little light now.
Yeah, they're empty, mostly.
It was for science, though.
It was.
So it was worth it. Ryan, what did we find here? Oh, excuse me, the choke. A Carlson's turkey choke.
Yeah, correct. So Carlson's extended turkey full. You know, pretty standard choke. You're gonna be able to pick up one of those pretty affordably.
Yep.
Good chokes.
I've killed a lot of birds with it. Hammered a fair amount of birds at that, you know, 30, 40, 50 mark with it. Absolutely pounded them, you know, no survivors. So it worked good at those distances. You know, and at that time, actually, I'd run in just the front beat.
Yeah.
You know, that's kind of before Red Dogs really, really, I feel like they've really come into fashion like the last couple years.
Yeah.
You know.
For sure.
On turkey guns,
for sure.
I should say. What did you find, Ryan? What were kind of your perceptions here? And I've got the targets here. We've got the targets here. Now, one thing that we don't have, and this was a casualty of the rainstorm. We had these True Glow targets. This is the 10-yard one. I'll hold that up here. Very effective at 10 yards, by the way.
I would say probably not going to survive that.
Right. We had backers that were, I guess, a less durable type of target paper.
Yeah.
Which we had them, I guess, intentionally in place to capture, you know, any pellets that landed outside of the zone. We lost those due to the wet conditions.
Yeah.
So,
call it the gross pattern.
Yeah. But some very important information there that we don't have right now. And we'll kind of speak to that a little bit later. But
we learned a lot. I want to go over some terms just so we can shore this up for the more science procedure folks listening. So a couple things. We didn't chronograph the load out of this gun. We're working on the pellet counts and muzzle velocities as established by Federal on the box. So using it as a baseline, 1,200 foot per second, 330 pellets per charge. I did not cut one of these open to count. Mark still has to get through several turkey hunts this year, and I think we left him with 9 shells. Should be good in zero, though, so you're good to go. At least 9 turkeys. I'm just going to tell you that.
Perfect.
We did establish a zero at 25 yards. Did that first by using a double A. Actually, we fired 2 double A's through there to kind of roughen the red dot, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
And then confirm pattern with a single load of TSS. And actually, it was on the money. So the 10-yard impact was as you would see it from the shotgun with no other manipulation or adjustment out of the out of there. So great tip. If you haven't heard us talk about this before in the podcast or in any of the conversations we've had about it, if you're putting a red dot on your turkey gun, take care of the roughing in, if you will, with the inexpensive trap loads or field loads. One, it's going to save your wallet. Two, it's going to save your shoulder. And yeah, much more economical and sensible way to go about that.
You will expedite the process, save yourself, like you said, save a little money, save your shoulder.
Yeah, yeah. And then the nitty gritty on the, like the ballistics part of this, I found ballistic coefficient data for a number of different shot pellet diameters. It was somewhat variable. It's difficult to calculate. I came up with an approximate BC of 0.018 per pellet. Each pellet weighs 3 grains, which is significant in the rest of this. We come up with a per pellet energy at muzzle of 9.59 foot-pounds of energy and a total pattern energy of 3,165 foot-pounds of energy. That's all the pellets together at the muzzle, what they're going to, you know, calculate out to in total foot-pounds of energy. Now, when we go over to the chart as we're going down this in the yardages, when we have total pattern energy, we are going to count pellets on target, meaning only in the vital zone of the turkey target in this case. Like we had more pellets hit the paper, which would skew the total pattern energy, but we're counting like lethal impacts on this one. So if it hit the turkey head on the target, that is what we are counting as total pattern energy in this chart that, that we'll also have on the graphic as well for the, you know, each target. So a couple things. PPE stands for per pellet energy in foot-pounds, total pellet energy, TPE, PCOT, pellet count on target, so that's the number of pellet strikes in the turkey head, FPS is foot per second, FPE is foot-pounds of energy. So let's jump in.
Let's do it. A lot of terminology there,
yeah,
Ryan. Like I said, I can't compliment you enough on this chart. So we showed the 10-yard target.
Yeah. Devastating.
Devastating.
Wad strike probably would have been terminal, by the way, because I had to pull it out of the plastic corrugated backer, like remove it with force.
Right.
Yeah.
I watched, actually, it was this one. So we'll have an Instagram reel as well that's going to show these impacts. That should be really cool
to watch. Oh, that's
right. We
filmed it.
So, but yeah, I watched that wad go through and definitely went through with authority. I was like, yeah, if a turkey's head was there, he'd have probably been in trouble. But again, I'll hold this one up again. I mean, it's just like, you know, I'm looking through it right now.
Yeah.
I'm looking at you guys. Yeah, I mean, anything else to add to that? I mean,
no.
And really, I mean, this isn't necessarily going to be unique to TSS,
no,
right?
No, no,
so,
no.
I mean, you know, at 10 yards. I think also important to point out, though, you look at how tight that pattern is, and we've talked about this before, at 10 yards. You call in that bird, and you think, oh, my gosh, this is a lock. This bird's 10 yards. You're a goner. Get a little excited. Pull the shot a little bit.
Yep.
You can miss that bird because that pattern's so tight. So this shot pattern that we seek of getting, you know, basically these super tight patterns can be detrimental.
Absolutely.
At a close distance if you're not on target.
Absolutely. And this is, again, to speak to the credit or to the benefit of running a sighting device on your shotgun. It's easily observed. Point of aim and point of impact may not be what you think it is with a bead front sight, right? The red dot allows you to shore that up. And there was significant adjustment required when I had first set this on. As I would have expected, we took a red dot out of the box, put it on the shotgun, right? It's set up at mechanical center. You know, significant adjustment to get it lined out with where the point of impact actually was with the shot column. And moving down range, this helped tremendously with establishing like a consistent hold point on target. So I don't know that I would have been able to have done this test as well were it not for the red dot on there.
Mm-hmm.
Close in birds, the reason I shoot an optic on my shotgun is I missed a turkey at close range. I probably could have mitigated that with a red dot.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, also, to point out there, you mentioned, you know, downrange.
Yeah.
Right? Speaking of downrange, we have downrange right here. This is the 20-yard target that I'm holding up right now. Still a very nice pattern. Very effective pattern. How many pellets in the kill zone here, Ryan?
Picot number of 107. So 107 impacts inside of that turkey's noggin.
Got them.
Yes. What's interesting, though, is to see how quickly pellets shed velocity and energy. So backing up to 10 yards, we have a total pattern energy, so impact on target, of 1,676 foot-pounds of energy, mm-hmm. which is catastrophic. When we get to 20 yards, even with 107 pellet impacts on target, we have dropped down to 600 foot-pounds of energy, which is nothing to sneeze at. That's still Magnum handgun energy. But you lose 1,000 foot-pounds of energy in 10 yards. So in part one, pellet shedding velocity and in turn energy. And then two, dramatically less pellets on target. So we go from 243 impacts to 107 impacts. So we can start to see now how pellets are an inefficient projectile with respect to energy and velocity retainment at distance. Mm-hmm. And then two, spread begins to take hold. And we decrease efficacy and lethality exponentially as we go down the line.
Now, in contrast to that, though,
yeah.
the beautiful thing about a shotgun is that it does have that spread. I mean, yes. I'm not telling most people anything they don't know. So I'd say at distance, if you did have a little variance in your aiming point,
you also have forgiveness.
You have forgiveness here as well. Yep. So it's kind of like there's a little bit of a yin and yang going on there for sure. And I'd say particularly more so with the front bead, which is just you're just going to be a little bit, or you can be less precise. Like I don't want to diminish the effectiveness of a front bead. I've used it a lot, killed a lot of turkeys with a front bead.
Yep.
But your level of just confidence and accuracy in seeing the bird. Now we're turning this into a red dot. This is TSS talk.
Yeah.
30 yards, Ryan.
Same. We're starting to see dispersion of the pattern. I'm a little bit, am I a little left of center on that one? A little bit?
Maybe
no,
a little
I've been right of center, so little, from my perspective.
A little bit right of center.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But nonetheless, dead bird, we're still talking about 41 impacts, you know, grand total of just shy of 200 foot-pounds of energy on that bird's head neck area. That's a cooked bird. I have also heard, and we should note this, anecdotal evidence states that 2 foot-pounds of energy is required to break the bones inside of a turkey's neck.
Okay.
Now, what I could not substantiate is whether that is just 2 pounds of energy hitting the turkey, or is that penetrating through their, you know, elastic neck meat and skin and then getting to the bone and breaking it. These are all questions that I want to deep dive into and put myself into financial obscurity, purchasing TSS, steel, lead, whole bunch of shotguns, wads, reloading equipment, and then like crawl into my basement for 3 years and...
Right. I can't remember if I mentioned this in the intro. I think I had at least thought about doing this, but you know, we're talking about this in the context of this might be the first installment because I feel like by doing this test we've opened up a proverbial Pandora's box of TSS turkey load testing.
Yeah.
Which might lead to some really, really fun stuff. And you know, hopefully you make it out of that dark hole you crawl into for the next year.
I hope so.
40 yards.
40 was interesting because it was not drastically dissimilar to 30.
Mm-hmm.
Did not see a huge, and even on the big part of the patterning board, did not see a huge difference in the pattern performance in like overall spread compared to 30, which was super curious because we all stood and looked at that one for a little bit like, well, that's interesting.
Yeah.
Did not have a good explanation for it. Could have been an anomaly. I think if we reconduct this test, we're going to need about double the shotgun shell ammunition quantity count.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to like do it twice at each yardage. And I want a larger patterning board to get us a better picture of this.
Yeah, because we're looking at a Peacock pellet count on target at the 30-yard mark at 41. 40 at 40 yards.
Yes.
40-40.
Yes. Nearly identical.
Nearly identical.
Yeah.
You also... kind of maybe as we get to the 50-yard mark, and we'll do that now because I think it does warrant talking about. I've got this target here. Dramatic fall off.
Yes, big time.
At 50.
Yes.
That's also where we start to see gravity come into play, I feel, a little bit more substantially. It's almost like from 50 on out, we start to see some drop. Not surprising.
Yep.
Not surprising. But, yeah, this one... I'd say still a dead turkey.
Probably.
We're
still hitting it with 160 foot-pounds of energy on the noggin.
Yeah, you've got pellet in the brain, right at the eye. You've got a couple right on the spine there, close to it. You know, below that, who knows how many pellets to incapacitate the turkey, potentially, if you did need a follow-up. I don't think you would. I think this is killing the turkey.
Likely. We're still at a per pellet energy of 3.5 foot-pounds.
Mm-hmm.
So if we're adhering to the 2 foot-pound rule, we're lethal plus change.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Now, also here, now, Ryan, correct me if I'm wrong, but, you know, we're talking about trajectory and that coming into play. So we've got, you know, 1.8 inches of drop at the 50-yard mark.
Yep.
But we weren't necessarily, you weren't at this point in the experiment, not changing your point of aim, correct?
That's where we started to at 60 and 70 and beyond.
Okay.
Yes.
Gotcha.
And this is where you're going to see a dramatic difference in the patterns. So if we look at 50, there's a handful of impacts above like the turkey's head. Not a ton, but a handful. And if, again, we don't have those big giant paper targets that disintegrated into the rain, very few impacts above the target part of this. Like, so the larger backer paper would have extended up about a foot above this target.
Right.
Only a handful in the 50-yard target. And then it was obvious to us that, okay, we need to start accounting for trajectory, which, forgive me, this is something I should have run ahead of the test so that I could have had an idea of what trajectory was going to do. Tricky part was shotgun. So we're not only dropping at a constant rate, but we're also spreading at a pretty unpredictable rate. Like, we don't know where an individual pellet is going to leave the shot column, go up, left, right, down, sideways, or otherwise. So you're battling gravity, of course, and then you're also battling that just kind of errant trajectory of each individual pellet within the shot string, or the shot column, rather. And it's difficult to account for. You can, though, and it does, like, we did see it play out. When we started getting into the extended ranges, we were making, like, conscious holdover effort to impact target. And it makes a lot more sense the further out we go, especially when we get to 100, because then it was like, okay, let's really give it some holdover and see what happens.
Mm-hmm.
But if you look at 60 and 50, again, don't look dissimilar, but we're starting to do a trajectory correction. And actually, 60 outperformed 50 by 5 pellets on target.
Right.
And so here we're making an effort to hold over.
I think they say, I'm going to check my own math on this.
Yeah.
I think they say like 4 pellets in the vitals is kind of like that baseline of dead bird.
Could be, yeah. The part that's missing is how much energy does it take to get through the skin, to get through the muscle, the connective tissue, then get to bone, and either get to CNS tissue or like the jugular or the brain, something like that.
I think there's some things that we can do with potential research that's already been conducted, as well as potentially maybe a little gelatin, a little ballistics gel.
I like Ryan. That.
I don't know. That sounds... I'm curious. I'm very curious. So, yeah, we're looking at 60 yards, 15 pellets on target, a drop of 3.6 inches, right? So, again, you were holding over a little bit for this one then?
Yep.
Okay. So, and, you know, it definitely translated into, you know, at least what appears to be more pellets on target. And I think one thing, we got a lot of good data from this test. I'd say... like inconclusive in some way. Like, I think
we've
got some conclusive, but some inconclusive data here, you know. So, but it's all information we can use.
Yep.
All right. We're at 70 yards, Ryan. 70 yards, 6.2 inches of drop here.
Yep.
8 pellets on target.
Yep.
627 feet per second.
Yep.
You know, when I think of some of these feet per second, I think of these, you know, kind of like as a BB, if you will, out of a BB gun,
yep.
You know, or like I'm using that as an analogy.
Yep.
A single BB going 627 feet per second.
Be a spicy BB gun.
Yeah. You know, I think a lot of, you know, your standard BB guns that go in that, you know, 600-800 feet per second.
Yep.
I mean, you can kill birds at distance.
My neighbor had one of the 800 foot per second ones. Whew. Got a raccoon with it.
Yeah. I mean, I killed a bird at over 100 yards, open sights, one of my better shots, with a standard pellet gun.
Incredible.
I did it in front of my mother.
Things of our youth. It was a starling.
I don't. It was a starling. I don't do those things anymore. Well, starlings actually.
So 70 yards, though, that's where we dip below the 3 foot-pounds of energy per pellet, and we get into the twos. And now it's like, is this risky?
2.6 to be exact, or by your calculations, 2.6.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that's a question to ask.
We're talking about 20 foot-pounds of energy on target, just shy of 21.
Mm-hmm.
So pretty anemic. And this is a question, like I said, is 2 foot-pounds of energy on target considered terminal? Like, is that what'll do it?
Mm-hmm.
If so, maybe. Drop became a big factor. Wind was also a factor out there. It was a little breezy, not terrible. But that's something, when I hop online and I read about these guys obsessed with pattern density performances, wind is something they talk about all the time. And of course, it makes sense, right? You have a very low ballistic coefficient on the projectile. Granted, it has a small cross section, so it's probably not going to be as affected as like a 45 ACP bullet. But way less mass. Wind is going to be able to move that thing quite a bit. Something to think about. Now it's getting really spooky. Really spooky. You're looking at 8 pellets on target. Abysmal.
Yeah. I mean, it's definitely, you're starting to get down there.
Yep.
With the total pellet energy, and this probably isn't a fair analogy, but it came to mind. When you think of a lot of even modern compound bow setups that are incredibly effective at killing game. Big game. They have, 50-ish, foot-pounds of energy. So, like, again, I don't know if there's any sort of correlation there.
Well, there is, but energy is not the whole
part
of the discussion, right? So we look at the mass of one of those arrows. Some of these guys shooting 4 or 5, even 600 grain setups.
Mm-hmm.
The mass allows it to carry and carry with it the delivery mechanism of
death. In a single projectile.
Correct.
Yeah.
And we're talking about now a cutting device that's being pushed and traversed through the entire body cavity.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of times getting full pass through even extended distances.
Right.
Because it has that mass to push it through there. Well,
right.
Granted, it doesn't have the velocity and then the energy number that comes along with it. We're now putting a Ninja Bullet Blender through something in total.
Mm-hmm.
In this case, my big looming question is, do we have the mass, the energy, the penetrating ability to even get through the first couple layers of tissue into the good stuff?
Drive through into the vitals. Yep.
Yeah, and that's where my big looming question mark is. And then when we get to like 80 yards, for instance, we have, Mark.
Yes.
I'm sorry, I picked it up. I got excited.
Don't touch my turkeys.
2 pellets on target. 2. Mm-hmm. And that, for me, it's like, wow. Okay, that's not great. We're still above the 2 minimum requirement. We're at 4.6 total pattern energy.
Mm-hmm.
But man, that is a skinny, skinny pattern. One of those pellets struck like the flap, the dewlap on the bird. We gave him a tattoo more than anything.
Yeah, it's almost like there's even just like a hole in the pattern there.
Yep.
Which is interesting. So that's at 80.
Yep.
90.
Nearly identical.
Identical. It's almost like our 30-40 and our 80-90, other than the numbers that are attached to the pellets.
Yep.
But the hit percentages there are about the same.
Abysmal. 544 foot per second per pellet. Very slow. We've dropped off significantly. 2 foot-pounds of energy per pellet. 4 whopping foot-pounds of energy on target. Both of them, though, both strikes would be vital.
Like, right.
Yep.
That's where you get into the tricky part. You can say like, oh, that's ineffective. Like, I don't know.
Maybe.
Is a dead turkey ineffective?
Maybe. And then 100, of course, came out as being surprisingly interesting because here we had a more gusto in the holdover. So if you're looking at the target on the table here, my dot would have been placed approximately here.
Okay.
Relative to the target, maybe a little below that. So I'm going to say, about 10 inches above the center of the target. And we have about 19.9, or we'll just round it up and say 20 inches of drop at that distance. And interestingly enough, you could draw like a water line across the top pellet here.
Right.
There was 0 pellets above it.
Interesting.
Everything was below it. So could I have lifted that even further? Well, certainly. I had 20 inches of drop. So, if I would have done my homework ahead of time and been like, oh, we have 20 inches of drop at this, I need to hold 20 inches above the center of my intended point of aim, or point of impact, rather. Would I have had even more than 7 pellets total on target? Great possibility. But we didn't. So
again, that's where like the loss of those pattern boards like really could have come into play, because essentially the way we had them set up, to my knowledge, since like and you were there conducting the experiment, I was not, but I was hoping to be able to take this and then like move it kind of down the appropriate distance and see where maybe some of those other holes lined up. So it may be something that we're able to do in a future experiment.
Round two,
yes. But very interesting, though, because we're going, we ramped it back up. Like, even without maybe holding the appropriate distance, we've ramped it out, and we've got seven.
Yes.
Seven pellets in the kill zone.
Yes.
And again, that's where you get in that conversation. We keep repeating ourselves here, but does it have enough energy? Does it have enough mass? Does it have enough momentum to penetrate? Like, even though it penetrated the paper just fine, but, you know, is it going to kill that turkey? I mean, it's a question. I'm not going to say that it doesn't.
Sure, because I honestly, I don't know.
But very, very interesting stuff. Now, earlier we talked about, well, first off, like what would you say, what's your overall impression of like what we did here?
I think it was interesting. I think it gave us an idea of pattern performance at distance.
Mm-hmm.
And then left me with a lot of things that I would want to try.
Mm-hmm.
To, you know, introduce a different variable and see if we got something better or worse.
Right.
Like, I don't know that I can necessarily establish this as a baseline. Like, well, this is what the gun and the loading is capable of. You know, I actually think it's probably capable of a lot more.
Right.
And I think really the biggest part is changing the choke out and seeing if a different choke tube with a different means of you know, wad slowing or wad restriction or constriction or otherwise is going to yield some sort of different result. If you get on the internet and you start looking again at these guys and gals that are pattern obsessive, and they go through 10 different choke tubes, 10 different loadings, 10 different wad styles, they come up with results that are drastically different than this.
Right.
We also use kind of a non-standard target. So a lot of the folks I've been reading are using 10-inch circles and then total pellet count within the 10-inch circle to determine lethality.
Okay.
We're using something that is taller than it is wide and significantly. So are we short selling ourselves? I think perhaps. Are we presenting a more realistic target? Perhaps. Great question. I think that, again, I'd like to attack this or approach this with, like I said, a number of different choke tubes of different styles. Like, this is straight constriction. There's no wad stopping or wad pausing, component to this choke. It is simply a choke. It's not like a pattern master or an Indian Creek or some of the other designs that actually use a feature in the choke tube to impede, stop, or pause the wad as it's getting to the end, separating it from the shot column. So maybe those will yield different results. Maybe they don't work good with this particular type of wad. This is a rear deploying wad as opposed to a front deploying wad. There's a lot of different things I want to jump into and find out whether or not it'll work. Here's what I did learn, though. Unquestionably, if you went out and you bought a $40 Carlson's turkey full, I think pretty safely to 40 yards, you've absolutely smoked a bird. And unquestionably, right? And probably to even 50 and 60 yards. And especially if you're cognizant of trajectory. Because I think it's important. At 60, when you start to look at, you're actually getting measurable drop.
Right.
Then it's another conversation, right? Now I think, is 60 ethical at that point? And I think based on experiences you've had, experiences I've had, experiences a lot of other turkey hunters I've had with shot shell technology and like shot composition technology that's lesser than the TSS, the answer is yes, because I've killed birds at those extended distances with number five lead.
Right.
And smoked them. So I think 60 yards is probably a dead bird. I think comfortably, like looking at the numbers and just looking at the patterning board here, 40 and in, no question about it. That bird is cooked.
Oh, goodness. Yes. Yeah. You know, but you could say that with probably most modern turkey loads at the same time.
Yep.
So I think... you know, we're trying to, I guess, ascertain some of the differences, you know, between the TSS stuff versus maybe your standard, you know, lead loads or things like that. I mean, I look at this now, you're generally a little bit more conservative than I am, but I look at this and I go, well, I think I've got an easy 70-yard gun.
Possibly.
Now, I don't want to get roasted everybody here.
That's three turkey puns. Bird is cooked, roasted.
But we're not trying to get into the ethics argument of at least right now of what is ethical, what's too far here. You know, we're just trying to present some data.
Yeah, and we're also looking at this two dimensionally, right? So one of the guys that was with us, we looked at the 100-yard target and we compared it to like the 90 and the 80, and they're like, well, it's more hits on target. That's a dead bird. Or again, we're looking at just one single part of this. Like, what does penetration look like?
Well, and you're also looking at essentially a single shot at all these respective distances as well.
Yeah.
Shots 2 and 3 could look dramatically different at 100 yards. They could be better.
Yep.
They could be worse. A lot of variables at play here.
Yes. Yes.
But sorry, I interrupted.
No, I think that it's important when you're looking at the patterning board to understand that you're only looking at, one dimension to it, and I've gotten into this debate with 2 3/4 versus 3.5 inch.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you have a 3.5 inch payload, you have more pellets on target. They're not all getting there at exactly the same time. Okay. That shot string is elongated.
Sure.
And it's not maybe the most accurate representation of what's actually occurring here, especially mm-hmm. if you have a target in motion, or your target, anticipates shot, the target's moving.
Mm-hmm.
That 3.5 is debatably more effective, if not less. Who knows? Pattern density is a tricky thing because we see it just in the single format, holes in paper. You have to take from it what you can. And looking at this, I'd love to see what it does on the penetration side of thing.
Mm-hmm.
I'd also like to see what it looks like. Like, how are those pellets impacting that target? And at what interval? Like, what from the first impact to the last impact, how much time is there between it?
Mm-hmm.
And maybe that's outside of our reach and not worth the effort, but I'd love to see it. I'd love to just know what that actually looks like.
Ryan, they've got cameras that we can do that with, right? MC Ryan?
I think we just got a thumbs up, so yeah.
We'll hit buy now on whatever that camera is. Like I said, we got a lot of data here. Like, I wouldn't say we've drawn a final conclusion here. No. I think both you and I would love to do some further testing using the scientific method as much as we can. Like you said, Ryan, experimenting with different chokes, different shot sizes even. Like, if you go to the number 9s, you're going to have a lot more pellets on target. Now, that might affect your energy and penetration at some of those respective distances as well. So you're going to have different variables at play there. Reloading.
Yep.
You could dive into that wormhole.
I want to.
And, and then ballistics gel tests. Potential for that as well as just research. I'm sure, the good folks at Federal, I would imagine they've done some testing on these things and have some great data.
Yep.
So there's just lots to learn. Exciting stuff to learn, though.
It is. It was very telling to me. I think it's going to ruin all my non-TSS loads that I've been using for years successfully. So
those things.
It's funny. I was setting up
those old things,
a new 20 gauge, and I was thinking, like, do I have time to get some TSS 20, and do I have time to go test a smattering of choke tubes? Because a whole new system for me. I've not tested any choke tubes in it. The short answer is I went on all the websites where you can buy all the things. The answer is no. I'm going to just have to deal with the regular old standby turkey loads and just be cool with it. And maybe I'll assign myself a maximum yardage, and that's fine too. But it is cool to start thinking about talking about. And yes, I have a MEC 600 and 12 gauge now, so I do have the ability to probably start loading these and see what I think about it. So,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I think I think by nature as hunters, we want to be as effective as possible. I think we're curious. We like to, find. I mean, you don't know how far you can go,
right?
Unless you test the limits, right? So we're not necessarily advocating taking long shots
at
turkeys, but it's good to know what a system is capable of.
Yep.
Part of the big fun parts of turkey hunting is calling them in close, right? Yep. You get to interact with that bird and see them in close and strut. And another thing to think about, though, is not all first shots are perfect. You might get a running second shot at a bird that now maybe he started at 40. You got some pellets in him. You know he's crippled. You want to anchor that bird. So again, like, these things can come into play at different times.
Absolutely.
Too, so
yeah. And I mean, you say that not all first shots are perfect. That's about. I get so buck fevered when it comes to turkeys. It's not even funny. And so that's happened to me a lot.
It is one. I think my heart beats harder when I have a goblin turkey coming in than when I have a deer within bow range.
Yep.
And I love whitetail hunting.
Yep. Something about turkeys.
There's just something about turkeys.
Yep. They can yell at you. They hear better. They see better. Everything. Don't move. Oh, gosh. Make your safety quiet when you're pushing it off.
Fascinating birds.
Yeah.
Love them. They drive me nuts. I think that's also what I love about them. Thank you, Ryan.
Yeah.
How was your shoulder?
Fine.
Good?
Yeah, Benelli inertia operating system, very, very low recoil. A lot of people debate that to the moon, too. It's my preference. I like the feel of that recoil as opposed to like a gas piston operated or short stroke gas piston thing. I like the inertia guns. That was quite pleasant.
Excellent.
Yeah. And it's a big payload, too. It's no slouch. What is it? 1.75 ounces. That's a heavy load.
That ought to do it, right?
Yep. That's a heavy load.
So, well, thank you for doing that.
Heck yeah.
Thanks for getting all this data. I feel like we've lit a spark as far as our own curiosity here.
Spark.
Oh, my gosh. Pun number 7, 8, or 9. Hopefully, the listeners / viewers out there found this helpful. Also, if you guys are curious and want to know more and possibly want to see us do some additional experiments with different loads or chokes or shotguns or whatever, let us know. Let us know in the comments. Let us know what you want to see, what you're thinking about. Let us know what you found. Maybe you've done some testing like this. We want to hear it. We're here to learn, people.
Yes.
Thanks, everybody, for listening. Take care. Happy hunting and shooting. We'll catch you on the next one.
See ya.